this is what corn looks like.
Impressive, isn't it? You'll never see something quite like this in the wild. Corn has very few lateral branches, so we can plant them at high density. On the other hand, its wild ancestor, teosinte, has a lot more branches. During domestication, people kept on selecting plants with less branching until we finally have a plant that looks like this.
Oh, that's interesting. But why does corn have fewer branches? What happened during domestication?
That's a good question. Let's go back to the lab. It turns out that a gene called TB1 is responsible for branching. TB1 stands for teosinte branched 1. Could you come up with a hypothesis to explain the function of this gene and why there are fewer branches in maize?
It's called the branching gene, so my hypothesis would be that TB1 causes the plants to branch more. In maize, somehow this gene is not doing its job.
That's a perfectly valid hypothesis. Let's see if it's supported by data. In your hypothesis, the potential cause is TB1 gene, and the potential effect is the degree of branching in plants. To set up the experiment, we need to alter the potential cause first, or the so-called independent variable.
Well, the potential cause in my hypothesis is the branching gene. How do I change it? Can I take it away from the plant?
You certainly can. There is a TB1 mutant plant where this gene is not functional.
Okay, I know I always need a control group and an experimental group. So my control group will be the one with the normal plant, and my experimental group will be the mutant plant, right?
Exactly. Now let's look at what happens to the potential effect, or the so-called dependent variable. We already know that maize plants have fewer branches. Now, let's look at the mutant.
Oh, there are a lot more branches in the mutant. I'm a little confused. If the function of TB1 is to promote branching, wouldn't I see less branching if I take it away?
Maybe. Its function is not to promote branching. What would make more sense to you?
Well, it makes more sense if TB1 inhibits branching. Then, when I take it away, I would see more branching.
Well done. In this experiment, you are taking away the gene, so the independent variable is decreasing. The outcome here is more branching, so the dependent variable is increasing. When the two variables are moving in opposite directions, you have an inhibitory connection. One more thing. In this experiment, we took away the cause, so this is a loss of function experiment. It is used to test whether cause is required or necessary to produce the effect.
So the conclusion would be that TB1 is required to inhibit branching?
Exactly. What do you expect to see if you increase the expression level of TB1?
Well, it inhibits branching, so I'd see less branching, right?
Well done. In this experiment, since we increased the independent variable, this is a gain-of-function experiment. We can conclude that TB1 is sufficient to inhibit branching.
Do we need to perform both loss of function and gain of function experiments?
Well, it makes a stronger case. If you can demonstrate that TB1 is both required and sufficient to inhibit branching, you can conclude that TB1 is the major player in this process. I have one more question for you. Where is TB1 gene expressed?
Well, its function is to inhibit branching, so it has to be there to do the job, right? I'd expect to find TB1 protein in those cells that have the potential to form branches. When TB1 is there, those cells will not form branches.
Exactly. This type of evidence is called correlation. Since we didn't manipulate the level of TB1 gene expression, we simply measured it. Now, let's do a quick summary of what we have discussed so far.